This video is sponsored by ABC Leisure Group for everything to do with canal boats, marina moorings, hire boating, brokerage, chandleries, and off-grid electrical equipment. 7 a.m. one Saturday at the end of May. This is Birmingham in the Midlands, the heart of Britain's 2,000-mile canal network. While many of the boats moored here are resident or just passing through, 18 of them were ready to take part in an annual marathon challenge.
The challenge is a competition that takes place around the Birmingham Canal Navigations System, which is 100 miles of canals in Birmingham and the Black Country. And the point of it is to encourage use of the lesser used sections of the network. The 100 miles is 50 miles or so of it is not that much used, doesn't see too many boats. So this event encourages use of that, keeps them clear, keeps them in use, and it provides a bit of a will to keep them operational.
Here's a map of the canals in the Midlands, and the bits being marked in blue are technically separate canals, but together they form the BCN, the Birmingham Canal Network. Competitors need to get around as much of this as possible.
Although it's a 24-hour challenge, it actually takes 30 hours because we do encourage boats to rest for 6 hours overnight or at some suitable point. So we start 8 o'clock in, half an hour's time, and then it runs until 2 o'clock tomorrow on Sunday. And boats, the 6 hours isn't set, you choose when you do that, but you can only score points in 24 hours, so hence it's the 24-hour marathon challenge.
Although John was the organiser, he was also going to take part to some extent on his own boat. My initial carriage would be narrowboat Mella Luca, whose owner and crew had kindly invited me aboard. At 8 a.m. precisely, all the teams were permitted to open the competition envelope, which gives rules, the points to be accrued for each section of canal, and some cryptic questions whose answers could be found along the canals. Bonus points would be given for correct answers. Teams have to study this carefully to optimise their route for a maximum score. With that done, every second started to count, so there was a hubbub of activity as the crew began to get the boat ready for departure. With competition veteran Richard Powell at the helm, Mella Luca set off without delay. Though, it must be noted, all entrants are firmly reminded they must stick to the canal speed limit and will have points deducted if they exceed 4 miles an hour. Since they're required to record their route and times, this is an easy thing to check for the organisers. With the boat already pointing down the Ouzels Street loop, it made sense to carry on around the loop to join the main line a few hundred yards away. On board, the crew were busy sorting out their favourite windlasses, ready for the many locks they'd tackle during the challenge. The flag of the Black Country was flown at the bow, a chain link to represent the area's industrial heritage, and the triangular shape of a kiln. Round the bottom of Ouzels Street Loop, you go past Sherborne Wharf. How lovely to have a balcony here overlooking the boats. As we came back onto the new main line, we re-met John, who'd reversed out and taken the fractionally shorter route. Surely this was a good omen, an early spot of a heron on the towpath. People often ask if there are fish in the canals. The number of herons proves such food is plentiful.
No,
Inside the boat, the crew were huddled over maps and the cruise log, trying to work out the best route. Lovely reflections in the still water. That's another of the little loops that go off the main line. It's Icknield Port Loop. And that's where the same loop re-emerges a few hundred yards further on. Directly opposite is one entrance to the Soho Loop. The canal heads very straight northwest here, and I thanked my lucky stars for such a glorious day. There are quite a few little disused stubs along the BCN, places where once boats would have gone to load or unload cargo at factories. At Smethwick Junction, the canal splits between the original main line dating from 1772 and the new main line, the latter having no locks and a more direct path. It was opened in 1838 to speed up transit of the boats. We took the old main line with the locks, partly so we could get to the spur off to Oldbury, but also because doing locks gains you points in the challenge. For this purpose, the crew jumped ashore, but the boat got stuck on high silt at the side and needed a push away with the pole. As you will see, the BCN is rather silted up. Once free, Melaleuca headed to Smethwick Bottom Lock, the first of three, where the crew had already emptied it of water and swung the gate open as we approached. Good teamwork in the locks is crucial to getting through them efficiently, which is what you need when doing a marathon challenge. The lock supervisor checked all was well. With the water rushing in, the boat rose swiftly, or as swiftly as anything ever happens on the canal. Speaking of teamwork, Anne had already gone to the second lock to get that one ready and open, so Melaleuca could come straight in out of the first. And yet more crew had gone to sort the third lock.
The idea is that every lock ahead should be ready for the boat to go straight in, and there's a person on every corner of each lock.
Soon enough, Melaleuca steamed ahead into lock two, the crew shutting the first lock behind as you are supposed to do. There's no hanging about, it's like a Formula One pit stop. As soon as the boat's in, the gate shut behind it, and the water's let in from the top. Of course, normally you take the locks gently and slowly, but in the BCN challenge, every minute counts. Lock number two, done. And whoosh, into Smethwick top lock. Sensing the urgency, the local wildlife wisely got out of the way. While the boat rose, the crew ran ahead to the engine arm aqueduct, which carries one canal over another. They were searching for the answer to a challenge question.
Now I'm looking for a clue, which is, what did Thomas Telford think of bricks on the engine arm aqueduct, which is that thing there? But I can't find any possible clue. I'm bewildered as to what that would be.
Well, the entire crew had a good search around to see if they could find the answer to their question, but no answer was forthcoming, so we've had to skip that one and press on.
Another tradition of the challenge is Barney the Dinosaur, who gets passed from boat to boat.
I wonder whether that's true about what's going on.
It really was a lovely day, and sometimes you'd never think you were in the middle of a hugely urban area. After we passed through Summit Bridge, I asked Simon, the boat's owner, why he enjoys the challenge each year and keeps coming back.
I can best answer that by giving you a story, which is the first time we did the challenge. We were going down Walsall Locks at 10 o'clock on a Saturday night. There was a mattress wrapped around the propeller, a piece of wood jammed between the side of the boat and the side of the lock so it wouldn't move, no water in the pound that we were about to go into, and the natives weren't friendly, which sounds like the perfect storm of the worst boating you've ever done. But I've never had so much fun in my life. We outnumbered the unfriendly natives. We had enough people to solve all of the problems simultaneously, and we got through, and there was a fantastic feeling of achievement. So it's just doing slightly hard boating in interesting places that I otherwise wouldn't do.
Somewhat disconcertingly, the canal runs directly under the M5 motorway here. Not just under like a bridge, they literally built the road over the line of the canal. It's an odd thought that so many thundering lorries and cars are overhead. We went past Spon Lane Top Lock. We'd be going down that later, and we spotted that someone had left all the sluice paddles up, which suggested the canal below was low on water and someone was trying to flush more through. That prediction would come unfortunately true, as you'll see later. Look, there are the open paddles. Here the motorway is going over the canal, which is itself going over another bit of canal under this aqueduct, and there's a railway line in the middle of it as well. As we headed towards Oldbury, the heritage working boats Atlas and Malus came towards us. Atlas is a powered boat towing the unpowered butty Malus. It was these craft I was due to spend the night on and would be joining later in the day, so we all waved at each other. You get bonus points in the challenge for towing a butty. There's the first of the six Oldbury locks. As before, the crew disembarked to set about working the lock gear as efficiently as possible. You can see Melaleuca at the bottom of the image, heading under the bridge towards the second lock, with locks 3, 4, 5 and 6 ahead in the distance. In a flash we were through all six, and aiming for Titford Pools, one of several locations which score bonus points if you can reach them. You're required to take a photo of the boat there to prove it. You get bonus points because the locations can be awkward. In this case, very, very shallow water and a lot of silt.
Progress along this section can best be described as tentative. The boat is rather deep drafted, about 3 foot I believe, and you can definitely both hear and feel it scraping on the silt, so we're going along very, very cautiously.
Look how slowly we're going despite the engine still chugging away. That's the effect of there being very little water to float us in. But inch by inch we crept along and eventually made it to this odd bit where the canal ends in two giant reservoir pools under the motorway. Tea was called for. Right in the corner of the first pool is a little hidden exit to the second. but there's a very awkward 90 degree left turn to make. A shorter boat would definitely have the advantage here. This is the second of the two Titford pools. Bonus points for us. You have to turn around here, the canal ends, but weirdly going out we got totally stuck on the silt even though we'd managed to get in. The crew tried pushing off it. The captain tried reversing off it. And efforts were made to pole us over it, culminating in good old-fashioned donkey work to literally pull us through it. As we moved, I rescued a sad teddy bear who'd been face down in the canal. It just seemed wrong to leave her there. No sooner had we cleared that than the boat ground to a halt again, with unshakable clots of grot around the propeller. We were well and truly stuck.
Apparently the propeller is so jammed it won't even turn by hand, so now they're looking for tin snips to get rid of whatever's jammed round it.
The snips were secured by rope so they wouldn't be lost during the cutting. Then Simon braved his arm in the silty water to slice through everything caught on the prop. The crew endeavoured to keep us going by human effort, but to no avail.
Well, that cost us 45 minutes, and before anyone asks, yes, I did help with poling the boat off. Or didn't, if it means the crew get deducted a point for having an extra crew member. You take your pick.
This is the haul of junk pulled from underneath. No wonder the engine wouldn't go. As we came back to the Albury locks, ready to go down this time, Simon explained how bad it was.
On the way up, it was shallow and we were bouncing off the bottom, but we managed to keep going. On the way back, I must have been less lucky in my choice of route, and we got stuck a few times and had to reverse. And on one of the reverses, the engine just died and the propeller was not moving at all. And it must have taken about an hour to get it clear, I think.
How bad was that?
That's the worst I've ever had on this propeller. That was harder to remove than anything I've ever picked on this one before. Because you couldn't, it was so wrapped around the propeller was immovable by hand. So you couldn't turn the propeller to unwind the things that were wound around it. In the end, we had to turn it over on the starting handle with one person in the engine room while the other person unwound stuff from the other end and then back got it off, which was quite fortunate, really.
Having forgotten to hand Barney over when we passed Atlas and Malice, we finally got our opportunity. The crew of narrowboat Rebellion coming up the locks, happy to take the dinosaur further afield. They too were eager competitors in the challenge. Remember I mentioned the locks at Spawn Lane, where the paddles had been left open? Well, now it was our turn to go down there. This involved a ludicrously sharp corner. It was achieved with throttle and rudder, as well as David helping to pull the bow with a rope around a bollard. Into the first of three locks we went, but it was at the bottom of the flight where we discovered why other crews had been letting water through. Having edged out of bottom lock, Melaleuca once again found itself stranded on an insurmountable layer of gloopy silt. It was at least 2 feet deep, if not more, and the boat was trapped. Yes, I have sent a message to the Canal and River Trust pointing this awful spot out. We tried pulling the boat off again with ropes, to no avail. For a while, I thought our number was up. Then we let an entire lock full of water rush out, hoping to push the boat forward a bit. This worked.
Finally, we are free after riding the bow wave of a couple of lockfuls of water pushing us forward. That was the thickest silt I've ever felt on a narrowboat. It was just inches below the surface. It's no wonder we were making no progress, but we did manage to overcome, and perhaps I'm speaking too soon, but we shall be making our way further forward again, where I shall be changing boat.
And indeed we did get stuck exactly where I was recording that bit to camera. but more hard work by the crew floated us free for the third, or was it the fourth, time. Teddy was given prime position to dry off in the sun as we headed towards Pudding Green Junction. Here I departed with the plan to join another boat called Goosander. Goosander was coming this way and would be heading in the same direction as Atlas and Malus, which I was to join for the night. There's Goosander, shimmering in the heat haze. But just as they drew up, I received news.
My plans have had to change because Atlas and Malus, the paired boats that I was going to sleep on tonight, that were going to go up Farmers Bridge and Aston Locks and up round the sort of north side of Birmingham, they're now not doing that because they've been delayed, they're going slowest, they've gone a different route, and I was thinking I'd get a lift on that boat, but that was going in the same direction, and now they'll be different directions, and it all has become very complicated. But Atlas and Malus are going to be coming this way in a couple of hours, so I'm going to pretty much just sit in the sun for a couple of hours and wait for them to come past.
In fact, I didn't. John, who was only casually competing in the challenge because he was the organiser, offered me a bonus trip around the local area on his boat while I waited for Atlas and Malus. So we reversed up a little way and turned up the Gower branch, which links the old and new main lines. With the old and new lines being at different heights, we had to rise through three locks. 30 minutes later, we were heading west towards the Tiverdale Aqueduct, where the old main line goes over the top of the Netherton Tunnel branch. That's where I'd get off again and wait for my next ride. Here's the aqueduct. I bid John goodbye and went down to the canal below.
Just behind me that way is Netherton Tunnel, which is the route that Atlas and Malus, the pair and butty that I'm going to spend the night on, are apparently going to take. However, they have phoned to say they've got some horrible stuff wrapped around their propeller and now they're running late. So whether they'll actually make it here or not, I don't know. In the meantime, I've borrowed a chair from John and I'm just sitting by the canal, waiting for Atlas and Malus to turn up. It's quite pleasant, actually.
The shadows grew longer as the sun started to set, but at last there was a glimpse of two working boats coming my way. I hailed them as one might hail a taxi and leapt aboard just in time to go through the 1.7 mile long tunnel. It's very unusual in having towpaths on both sides due to it being such a busy route when the canal was industrial. Being so long, it was cold, dark and wet, and took about 40 minutes to get through, despite our vigorous pace. We were now on the Dudley No. 2 canal, and aiming to stop at a mooring spot called Withymore Island. We passed another competitor with merry banter. Soon after, we reached our designated stop for the night. This is a lovely set of private moorings with its own clubhouse, which meant I got to sleep on a sofa instead of the hard wooden floor of the boat. The next day, a further 8 hours or so of the challenge remained, and that'll be in the next video. Thanks for watching. Cheerio.